do a lot with other non-for-profits. That's the best part. I love what we partner with Camp Good Days. They have their junior Camp Good Days, which are 7-year-old and younger kids who have cancer. And they're too little to go to camp, so they do day field trips. And one of the field trips is they come here to the Pirate Toy Fund. We have a tent and tables and chairs set up. We have a picnic for them out back. And then they get to shop the warehouse. And sir, when you see their eyes walk into this warehouse and they start drooling because all, it's a blast. I'm telling you, it's priceless. So that's the part I love the best, that we can share what we do with other not-for-profits, excuse me, who have issues and stuff and need the toys for their kids.
I love it. Otto, let's dive right in. Let's get started.
You're the man. You tell me what you need me to do, my friend.
Welcome to Rochester Business Connections, powered by Baubert Marketing, LLC, where I get the chance to chat with Rochester, New York's very best business owners, entrepreneurs, and thought leaders. I am your host, Ben Albert. Don't forget to subscribe, and remember, we don't do advertisements. My fee for this show is simple. If you gain value from the episode, personally share with a friend and explain your favorite part. Let's get started. I am here with Otto, director at the Pirate Toy Fund. What's up, man? How are we today?
Sir, I'm doing great, and thank you so much for having us on your podcast. I love it. Thank you.
Hey, I'm happy to have you. Ultimately, I had Jason Tobias on the show. He's one of your partners at the Pirate Toy Fund. I was in the dark. I didn't realize the Pirate Toy Fund had been around 25 years, which is, I'm ashamed that I was in the dark on that. Jason kind of brought me into the light, and I really love what you guys do. So for anyone who might be in the dark still, or maybe they already support you and want to learn a little bit more, what's the Pirate Toy Fund? 25 years, right? Tell me a little bit about the history there and exactly what you do.
It was founded 25 years ago. There was this little girl, Christy Simonetti, who was battling cancer. And her parents was a big public drive for bone marrow. And then Gary the Happy Pirate kind of befriended her when she was in the hospital. And after she passed away, because she used to get a lot of toys, and what she would do is take some of those toys and give them to other kids in the hospital. So after she passed, they decided to create the Pirate Toy Fund, which is a non-for-profit that we collect and distribute toys all year round to children in need. It's a great organization, and her parents are still on my board to this day, Lori and Dave Simonetti, and Gary the Happy Pirate, as you know, just retired last June, and I took over his position.
I love it, and I love that you mentioned year-round. A thing that's been front of mind for me is digging the well before you're thirsty. Why wait till the holidays to do something good? Why wait till the holidays to show your gratitude, to help your community? Explain how this works. So you're distributing year round. What kind do the toys change year round, or give us a little bit more of the systems of how that works?
Yeah, we have 72 or 73 program partners. They apply online. We have a program partner committee that oversees that process to make sure we have enough toys to fill the orders for these agencies. We do strong Galisano's Children's Hospital. We do General Hospital. We do Red Cross. We do Salvation Army. And we started this program about 10 years ago, Toys on Patrol, where we put toys in police cars. So if an officer goes to a house and there's an issue with mom or dad or something, they give a child a toy so they don't feel isolated or they don't feel like it's the end of the world. And we also put them in the Monroe County Jail. So if a child has to go visit a loved one, we try to break down the barriers so that child gets a toy and makes the process a lot easier for that child. So again, not counting COVID, the year before, we gave out over 34,000 toys to those 70 plus agencies throughout the year. Some have camps, summer camps, and the hospital we do constantly, and some of the Red Cross, because they give to the kids that, you know, fire victims, things of that nature. Toys on Patrol. It's a bunch of programs that we give to surgery centers that handle kids. And I hear so much great feedback. It's how easy to give a child a toy before the surgery to break down the stress of a child and able to get him into the surgery when he, you know, departs his parents to go in. So I got involved about 16 years ago. I played Santa Claus at Galisano's. And this, I'm telling you, sir, this is where I found the love of the power of a toy. You can walk into a child's room, you can have the sickest of a child, and you give them a toy. For 1 minute, you take their pain away. For 1 minute, they forget everything except that toy you just gave them. So I was hooked, you know, since that time in the hospital, and I've been involved with it, and then I took over as the executive director. So if you, and I'm sure you can remember when your favorite toy was when you were a kid. So the power of a toy is unsurpassed, and that's what we do. You know, we try bringing smiles to children all year round and give them a toy when they're in need. We do another program, too. We start a partner with Monroe County Youth Services. They have a list of people that are in poverty. So what they do, by invitation only, the Blue Cross Arena, God bless them, they donate the Blue Cross Arena to us.
Wow.
And by invitation only, the kids come in, and downstairs is like a winter wonderland. We have Santa, we have Elmo, we have Rudolph, we have arts and crafts, we have snacks, we have games, and then they go up the escalator and shop for a toy. How often do these children get to do that? So for us, being able to do that is, I mean, we, 1 year we had 4,000 kids come through. It was so much fun. A lot of work, but it's well worth it. It really is. So we do this all year round when we can.
I love it. You know, a smile goes a long way. They're showing up to a jail, being in the hospital, these are sad, sad moments. And I remember when I was a kid, I had some sad moments like that, but I don't know if I even realized they were sad. I asked myself, is it good that I didn't realize that they were sad? I think in reality, you know, you provide a smile, you provide hope. Things are temporary, and it brings joy to children, which I think is a beautiful thing. I've got three questions rambling through my head, but I want to break them down. I like to ask like six questions at once. It gets ridiculous. So real simply put, you know, let's say I'm a business owner or part of a business. You know, I'm a partner in a business. Maybe I handle their marketing. How do I partner with the Pirate Toy Fund? How do those agreements look like? And to my understanding, you have a lot of partners, right? How would I get involved with that?
We do. We have a lot of smaller ones. One of our biggest financial supporters is Daisy Markey Jones Foundation, as well as Exceed Financial. And the biggest one this last Christmas was Mark's Pizzeria, Mark Crane Foundation. Those guys were phenomenal. And they heard us we do our toy drive with Channel 13 the first week in December, you know, promoting what we're doing and collecting toys. And they heard we were looking at a deficit, which everybody is during COVID. And they jumped right on board with advertising dollars. Mark Crane, his daughter, his wife, he calls me, meets me at the Walmart in Macedon, and he buys $5,000 worth of toys.
Love it.
Ben, we had card after card after card. They had a special cashier set up for us. I never had so much fun in my life as a 60-year-old man. I'm telling you, it was a blast. And it goes to show you the kind of people in this community. So if any business out there interested, just call the Pirate Toy Fund, or you can go, you know, on our website, you'll see, and just reach out to us. We can use, you know, we do buy toys throughout the years because there's some things that we're missing that we need for the hospital. So we get grants to buy certain toys. But operation costs, we're usually toy rich and money poor. So anything that a business can help us with, again, we're a 501c3, we give them a tax write-off letter, but every little bit of help. And this city is phenomenal. I don't know if you've lived here your whole life, sir, but
I have.
When the chips are down, they come out of the woodwork to help. They're there. I mean, this last Christmas when we had a deficit, and we almost, you know, made up that deficit because the city and the employees and the county and the surrounding areas sent money in, sent toys in. It was humongous. So, but yeah, please call us if there's anything you need. I'd love to sit down and talk to you and see if you can help us do what we're doing.
Yeah, I mean, I'm going to talk to you more about it. I have a few things. I want to work with you long term, but one of the things I'm going to enact for next quarter is I'm actually going to let my clients vote on charities because I want to be donating at least a fraction of my gross revenue to charity at all times for the existence of my business. So we'll talk more about that. Let's say you're a typical person from Rochester, you love your community. As you said, Otto, our community is very supportive, and you want to get involved in terms of, you know, donating financially. Can you donate used toys or is it just new? And how do you donate your time? I know that's kind of a three-part question, but.
There is. Right now, our time thing with COVID, we can't do a lot of events, so we don't need a lot of volunteers. Okay. We do a toy sort every year that we collect the toys and they're housed in a certain area. But per our 501c3, we have to count those and sort them and bring them to our warehouse. And we usually have a blast with the volunteers coming out for that, but we haven't done that yet due to COVID. It's a tough time. And I'm glad what you said about donating. I lost a lot of money at 12 years old, where my mother would make me go cut Mr. Johnson's grass and don't take a penny, or shovel Mr. Yitzhak's driveway, don't take any money. And that's one thing I could tell everybody. I don't care what charity you give to. Give to somebody. Give something back. Give something to help somebody else. Granted, if you help me, that's great. But if you can't do it, and if you have another love for some another charity, do it. The smallest of donations makes it work. You get, we take change. We got Shaler's has been a great partner of us collecting change at their restaurants. They've been phenomenal with that. That change goes a long way. People don't realize it. A couple quarters, dimes, nickels, whatever you want to throw in there, mm-hmm. we'll take it because that adds up. But they can help by donating a toy. Every mall has our toy boxes in it. Now we have a wish list too, an Amazon wish list. You can go right to Amazon, buy the toy, and they'll ship it right to us. So that's another way to get it. So during COVID, it helps you not have to go out and deal with, you know, people in stores and malls and stuff. But the malls have been great. They're open. We did a great job in collecting toys for us this year. And again, the smallest amount of money, you can go online. You can donate to us right online. But we'll take anything. But just give to somebody, you know.
I love it. And yeah, just give to somebody. That's a great message. Just give. And I'm lucky to be in a position where I wouldn't say I'm the most affluent person in the world, but I have room to give and I have more room to give. And I'm wondering on the other side of things, there are a lot of people that are struggling. They've lost their jobs due to COVID. There's stress at home and they might be in embarrassed to say they need help, but I'm curious, is there a way, let's say me or my family needs a little help and could benefit from the Pirate Toy Fund, how do you choose who to help? Can I reach out to you if I have a family in need?
You can. Me and you, we're buddies and friends, and if you have a family in need, call me. We don't usually do, we don't have an open door policy or open to the public. It goes to our program partners.
Got it.
And you mentioned something about used toys. We can't collect the used toys because, especially with the hospitals and surgery centers, things have to be new and clean. So, you know, we don't have the process of rejuvenating toys and cleaning them and sending them back out. So we don't collect used toys. But whatever we can do, if you've got a family in need, it's all about the child. So my board members, again, they're all volunteers. They do it out of the kindness of their heart. They're here because they believe in the cause. And like you mentioned, Jason, he just got on our board this year too. And he's been phenomenal. His enthusiasm is unsurpassed.
It's amazing.
Well, it is. It is. He gets going. He fires people up and stuff. But it's all about caring. It's all about having heart and giving back. And that's the best thing I love about our board. It's not about they're here to make money. They're not here to make a name for themselves. They're here because they believe in the cause. But yeah, if I know somebody, if the board knows somebody, call us. If somebody in need, we'll give you the toys, you know, especially if it's a child involved. That's our biggest heart, you know, goes out to, we don't want a child to go without, but we don't have the system set up that someone can just knock on our front door and collect toys. It has to go through one of our program partners.
Good to know. Good to know. It's great information for anybody who's going to get involved going forward. I want to learn just a little bit more about you. We got a lot of functional things down, but I'm wondering, Otto, you know, you started how long ago? Did you say 15 years ago you played a Santa Claus?
Yeah, 15, 16. I was on the board. You know, I was volunteering at first, then I got on the board, and the Santa Claus was the best. I'm a retired police officer from the Rochester Police Department. I was there for 33 years, and an old Captain Eddie Bastion, who ran Clinton section. I started playing Santa Claus back 35 years ago at Baden Street Settlement for the kids, for the elder. And I had a blast doing it. Plus my own kids. It was just, so I've had a suit for the last 35 years. But to go in and, like I say, with the hospitals and walk into a child's room and you can see they're in pain. You can see they're sick. And a lot of times they're alone because their parents have to work. They got to pay the bills, you know, and to give them a toy, Oh my God, Ben, I'm telling you, someday if we start doing it again, we cut it back because of COVID and flus, they won't let us. But it's such a feeling when you go in to see that child's reaction to that toy. It's huge. But I've been doing that for 35 years. I retired a year and a half ago from the Rochester Police Department. I love the job. I love what we did. I love that we did make a difference. But this has always been my heart, my charity. And I love, because I've done volunteer work at Camp Good Days, and I'm with the Story of Hope, where we're building a hospice house in Chilai. It's nice that you can help other organizations do what they do through a toy. That's the stuff I love. That stuff is, I'm telling you, it's grateful.
Yeah, thank you for helping the community. Thanks for serving the community. Are you born and raised from Rochester, or did you find your way here by chance?
No, I was born and raised. I have six brothers and sisters. I'm the middle kid. So I've been stressed ever since I was two, let me tell you. Three older than me, three younger than me. But my whole family is, you know, there's a couple of siblings that are down in Florida where my mom is now. She comes up for the summer. But yeah, born and raised. I love this community. I love what this community stands for. I think we have potential. I think we're going through some turmoil right now, as you see. But I have no doubt, and I have the faith that it's all going to get better. It has to get better. And it just, if people sometimes would just sit down and talk instead of yelling, I think we can go a long way with that.
Yeah, I'm with you. That's why I have this podcast. I'm all about having conversations. I almost asked what I determined to be a stupid question. I almost asked.
Go ahead, ask it.
Well, no, I mean, you can elaborate. That what I was going to ask is, you know, what is your why? What do you do what you do? But I feel like you've already explained that with some of the stories. It's very nuanced. You're looking to help. You're looking to support the children. You've serviced the community pretty much your entire career. Is there anything I just missed? I mean, what is the why? You're obviously passionate about it.
Well, I think it's the foundation. I think I got to give it back to my mom. You know, because I seen her, would she make food if, you know, middle of winter, bring it over to Mrs. Johnson's, drop food over here, go shovel this, cut the grass there. And I saw at a young age that you give back. You know, it's not about making that $12, you know, 12-year-old dollar that I was trying to make, you know, and I was trying to make a living, by the way. But it was about giving back. And that's the part I love that I was taught. And all my brothers and sisters are the same way. My oldest brother does a lot with the veterans outreach because he's a veteran and he's a former Secret Service agent. But he does a lot for the causes he believes in. We do give toys to the veterans outreach. We help the veterans that come back. We try to, and that throughout the year, it helps with their kids and birthdays and things like that. Some of those guys are still trying to get back on their feet. You know, a lot of them have a lot of issues coming back from wars and being overseas and stuff. And if we can help them with get toys to make them feel positive with their children, tell me that ain't a win-win for everybody, you know? So, but I was, you know, once you, and again, that I think it goes back to that time playing Santa Claus and seeing that first child that I gave a toy to, I was suckered into it. I'm telling you, I love the cause. I love the power of a toy, and people don't realize it. And if you go back and if you can sit for a second and think what your favorite toy was, that's the power of a toy because you remembered that toy, you know? So that's the part I love about this cause. And I love that it's all the board members, everybody that's here, because we're kind of a working board. We get involved in the fundraisers. We set them up. We tear them down and stuff like that. So the board's always involved in the events. They do it all out of the kindness of their heart. That's the best part I love about this cause. People are here because they want to be here.
Yeah, they want to be there, and they're doing great work. I'm imagining you with a big Santa Claus beard. I don't know if I can see it.
It's a pretty picture. Let me tell you, I could pull this up real quick. I'll show you, if I can get it up, but I'm just telling you, this is, it's rewarding. I do it for my godchildren. I do it for my grandchildren. My grandson's getting a little edgy and he's like, that voice sounds like you, Poppy. And it's like, so I got to come up with plan two, you know, so he doesn't do it again or figure it out. Telling you, it's so much fun. I do have one right here coming up, if you don't mind one second. Yeah. If I get to show it to you, I don't know if I can get it up.
Take your time with that. And one thing that came to my mind when you were talking about giving children toys is the power of touch, the power of being able to hold it and grasp it in your hands and feel the joy and feel the emotion. And have it be one of your hobbies and create a relationship with your toy. It's a very intangible thing that I don't think a lot of people talk about. I'm at an age where if you were to tell me, Ben, life is hard, but I promise it gets better, I would believe you because I know it's true. But as a child, you can't really just tell that to a kid and expect them to understand how complicated life is. But if you hand them a toy, you give them an opportunity to feel joy in that moment, and they'll learn how complicated life is over time. But if we can bring them joy, that's a positive thing. Otto, did you find the photo, brother? What's up?
I did. How? I don't know if you can see me, but that's me right there, my friend. So I have my moments, but you're right. It's all what you just mentioned. It's all about, I think it's all about character. If someone has character, they can do anything. They can step right up. They can help others. And that's what makes this world and this community a great one. So, and again, I've lived here my whole life, you know, and I was in, like I say, in law enforcement. So I see that the less fortunate and what they go through. And then there's some great people out there fighting to make it every day. So if I can help them, and especially in certain areas, I give a toy and then give a toy, you know, because some of our toys go to kids with disabilities. They go with, you know, some kids with, you know, Down syndrome. So the soft, you know, stuffed animal is more of a warm feeling for them, where something with noise they can't have, you know, because it just stresses them out. So we try to do that with a lot of our partners. If they request certain things, we try to help them out and get them to them.
I love it. I love it. Thanks again, Otto. Ultimately, I love talking about Rochester. I love that you're doing great things for Rochester. Let's step away from the Pirate Toy Fund for a moment and just kind of shoot the breeze on how great Rochester is, whether it's food, entertainment, hiking, community. What do you do for fun, man? What would you be doing on the weekend when you're just relaxing and taking some time off from all the work you do?
I love my yard. You know, I love that stuff. We just, my better half and I, we just built a carriage house because I collect Coca-Cola memorabilia. So I got, everything's in storage right now. So we built this huge, some call it a barn, I call it a carriage house, but it's got a front porch. It's gorgeous. I'm right now getting the wiring and done and the you know, gas done. And then I got to get the insulation in and then finally finish up the inside. But I love working on things around the house. But I love, people don't realize we have lakes. We have a river here. You know, we have creeks here. And just to go in a beach, I mean, a lot of communities don't have beaches. You know, go down to Shalott or Hamlin Beach, just go hang out for the day and cook some hot dogs on the grill. It's a blast with the grandbabies. And sometimes I just love going for a ride. You know, my parents, when we were kids, we sit in the back and we all fought over the seat because my dad, if we got him upset, he tried reaching for you. But if you were behind him, he couldn't get to you. So okay. That was the seat we would fight for when we went for car rides. So you can put that. I used to love going for rides. We just take off and I love the fall. I love the fall here in upstate New York. I love the trees, colors and everything changing. And I just think it's a great place to live. I, you know, everybody says a lot of the guys, well, I'm moving to Florida. I'm done. Well, yeah, I like to vacation in Florida, but this is home. This will always be home. You know, all my loves and everything are here. You know, the causes I believe in are here. Yeah, I might take vacations, go away, but I want to be here to do what we got to do. And like I say, we're going through some turmoil times right now, but I honestly believe this community is so strong. It's going to get past it. It's going to fix it. And we're going to get stronger from it.
I love it. I love it. Yeah, I love that we have all four seasons. We have a beautiful fall. And eventually, I'm going to want a vacation home in Florida. But pro tip, nowadays, you can have a home and you can rent it out while you're here in Rochester. You can Airbnb it and then just go vacation there for a couple months during the winter or whatever time you'd like.
You know what I love to do? I love to be different places. I've been to Paris. I've been to Italy. I've been to Mexico. So I don't want to just buy a house in one place because I want to change. I'd rather just go rent someplace for a couple months and change where I want to go. I can go overseas. I can go anywhere, you know, United States. But I want to meet different people. I want to go to different locations. You know, And if I want, you know, my mom's in Florida, so I can go visit her and stay with her and stuff. But I love just being able to go to different locations. I want to get a motorhome. My brother and I are talking about it, just to travel with the grandbabies. And he wants to take his kids are going to college and they're big in basketball and lacrosse and stuff. So he wants to take them to the games or go to the games over out of state. But I just want to travel. Eventually, when I'm done and retiring here, and I get us to the next level where I think we should be, and then find someone to have the heart to continue it to the further level. I mean, that's the part I'm looking forward to.
I love that. I want to travel as well. There's one thing that COVID brought this to the forefront, because simply put, I'm a huge music guy. You'll see me at music venues multiple days a week. All that got shut down. It's changing every single day. Very confusing. I have a whole basically music podcast where we talk about it all the time. It's a year worth of work when it comes to the music industry. But long story short, it kind of reinfused me with a need for travel, realizing that if this virus hangs out for a long time, the best thing I can do is just spend more time outdoors and spend some time maybe in a minivan or a mobile home and see the world. If let's say COVID's gone and you could go anywhere, whether you fly or drive there, where do you want to go? Is there any places that you haven't been yet or places that you went to in the past that you're just like, I got to get back there?
Listen, I loved it. My older brother, he rented a castle in Venetico. This was back in 2015, and all you had to do was get your airfare there. Then he rented a whole hotel floor in Paris. All you had to do was get your airfare there. Now, when it's my turn to treat the family, we're going to Batavia. Motel 6 for everybody. I'm going to hook up the muffins in the morning. But I love that, you know, we're supposed to go to Switzerland and Germany. He's doing the three-country thing. We're going to set that up, but that was put on hold due to, you know, COVID. I'd love to see the Great Wall of China. That's been on my bucket list to do that. I'd love to see the pyramids, you know, of Egypt. I'd love to. It's just things you see in books. When we went to Paris, I got to see the Mona Lisa, which was huge for me. But the only depressing part, the Mona Lisa is only like 8x11. You figure it was this big, huge portrait.
Sure.
But it's only like a piece of paper, 8x11. But it has like 14 inches of matting all the way around it. But it was so cool to see it. You know, it was so cool to go to the museum, things you only saw in books and papers, to go to the Vatican, to walk in and see the artwork on the ceiling. I mean, that stuff was phenomenal. So that stuff I like. I love when we used to go to the little towns in Italy and you go to these old churches and you see old tiles they put on 200 years ago, you know, on the walls and stuff, and how they did everything by hand is just amazing to me. I love artwork. I love looking at things like that. So eventually I'm going to get there. Hopefully I'll start traveling. My goal is every year do a big one and maybe a small one, you know, trip, and then just to see the things I want to see.
I love it. I want to see a lot of things as well. I believe in thinking big, and then we got to focus on day to day. How can I help the community? How can I help myself? How can I help my family where I can get to that level and make dreams come true? So to kind of just sidestep to a completely different topic, you know, mentorship and learning. As a director at the Pirate Toy Fund, you're a mentor to your team, you're a mentor to the children, your partners. I love having this podcast because I have an opportunity to surround myself with great people and learn from them. I genuinely believe no one can do it on their own. It's the people around them that helps bring out what they're strong at. And it's the team effort that really helps us accomplish huge things. And I'm wondering, whether it's current or in the past, where does your enthusiasm and your love for serving come from? Did you have a mentor that taught you that? Was it something that you just learned along the way? Or how has education and mentorship kind of played a role in your life?
I think you need education. You know, I do have my bachelor's. I've been contemplating going for my master's. I think education, you need that just so you talk. Not like you just came off the street, you know, people, especially when you're looking at, you know, multi-million-dollar companies to donate money to you, you have to come across very articulate and being able to get what you want. My biggest mentor, one of them is my mom. Like I told you in the past, she just was there teaching you. You got to give back. Don't get me wrong. I got a few whoopings from her too, but the best part she taught me was, you know, taking care of others, and she took care of my grandmother till she passed away. So that gave me a great value on family. It is a team effort. You know, people say, oh, you did a great job. Well, I couldn't have done it without, you know, Nan and Mary, my part-time staffers that are here. Those two are phenomenal. And you got to sell it to your team that when I first took over, I'd say, listen, guys, we're going to succeed together or we're going to fail together. So it's us. It's us against everybody else in a sense that we have to make this work. And they loved it. We've been partners. If there's issues, we address them right away. One thing I learned is that you don't let things fester. If there's a problem, address it right away. Talk to the person that the problem's with. Don't let it sit and talk to other people about it because it's not going to fix it. You know, it's not going to make it better. It's going to make it worse. Sometimes in law enforcement, I'm surprised we arrested people because sometimes the left hand didn't know what the right hand was doing and communication some kind faltered. So that's one thing when I took over this position, I wanted to make sure no matter what we communicate, we make sure what's good, bad, or different. Let's talk about it so it gets better. But I think that's just in any part of your life, you want to make sure you talk to your kids, talk to your spouse, talk to your neighbors. You know, look how many fights you see with neighbors and stuff. You know, and I saw the one where there was a video where someone got shot because there was you arguing over snow and shovels. It's crazy. You know, just talk to each other. But overall, I think Gary, the Happy Pirate, he taught me a lot, you know, that he, you know, founded this, like I say, with Dave and Lori Simonetti. Gary Mervis was the founder of Camp Good Days. Another man I picked his brain on and learned things from. You know, these guys have been doing it. I mean, Camp Good Days is going 41 years strong now. Wow. You know, so in order for what they do and stuff, I just think those are the guys that I look up to and learn from. But you can learn from anybody. The best part is you can learn from a two-year-old. You know, you can learn from somebody who comes in and grabs a toy, you know, and the statements they have are priceless. Sad part is we have kids that come here who are sick and they grab toys, but then we end up losing them. But the mother of one little girl that came here, she was in a wheelchair, came with Camp Good Days, picked out the biggest stuffed unicorn. Ben, I swear to God, it was 3-4 times bigger than she was. She ended up passing away like 4 weeks after she came here. But her mother said that toy did not leave her side. That stuffed animal enhanced her life for the last 4 weeks of it. So that's the part I love hearing. That's the part I love seeing. And that's why I believe in what I believe in here. But yeah, you have to make it a partnership. You have to make it with your staff that we're in this together. And you can always learn. That's the best part of about this. I don't know it all. This is my first executive director position. You know, I was a cop and an investigator with RPD. And, you know, but this is something I've always believed in and always been part of. But there's still a lot of stuff for me to learn, you know, and thank God I got people around me. Because one thing I know about myself, if I don't know it, I got to find someone who does. You know, so the answers are going to get answered and the work's going to get done. But I want to learn as I go along what it means and how to do it. So down the line, I can. I'm writing my first grants. You know, I never wrote a grant in my life, but I'm learning how to do that. And you need to. You need to make the money to help the cause. But overall, it's definitely a team effort. You have to talk to your people, talk to your friends, and that's how we get where we're at. Excuse me.
I love so much of what you said there, Otto. You know, just to summarize from my point of view, communicate, have conversations, have open-minded conversations, because communication's key. You want to surround yourself with good people that are willing to communicate and have similar values. At the core, that's one thing I believe. If I can agree with your values, we might disagree on just about everything. You and I will find a way to reach that value if we communicate. And the last thing that stood out with me is just the empathy for people, for the children. You know, you need empathy to properly bring joy. And I love that image of that little girl with her huge stuffed animal.
It was so much fun when she had to get on the bus afterwards because they didn't bring a bus for the field trips. And this poor girl, the thing again was 3-4 times bigger than she was. But she wanted that unicorn. And her mom said that stuffed animal did not leave her side for the last 4 weeks of her life. So that meant a lot to us. That goes back to the power of a toy. you know, and what we can do for a child. And it's, those are the sad ones. They're the ones we don't like to hear about, but they do happen. But if we can enhance their existence for a little bit more, let's do it.
I'm thinking in my head, you know, of just like small segments we could make, Power the Toy or Stories That Make You Smile. I don't want to start a whole new podcast live on the air right now, but let's get one more Stories That Make You Smile, Power the Toy stories, you know, just another image that I can, you know, smile about today.
This is another one. There was a little girl, and it was just this last toy drive. We do our finale of the toy drive at the Strong Museum. And this little girl, I think, went into one of the surgery centers and had a surgery done and got a toy from the Pirate Toy Fund. Her parents went out and spent $1,000 on toys. They bought them to the toy drive, and this little two-year-old girl was taking them out of the box and putting them in the toy box for the Pirate Toy Fund. What a way to teach your child to give back. And look at these parents. I was astounded by what they did. I think they were phenomenal. They had heart. They cared. But that one little toy they got from us made an impact so much on their child that they wanted to come back and give us $1,000 worth of toys to do that for a bunch of other kids. Tell me that ain't cool. Tell me that wasn't heartfelt. I mean, I almost had tears in my eyes when they showed up with them and we heard the story. Rebecca LeClaire, who's on our board now, used to be with Channel 10, phenomenal woman, does a lot for our organization, social media wise and stuff. She was even, you know, beside herself when this family started telling her the story. So we were blessed. I mean, that's how word gets out. That's how people see, they get impacted by what we've done and they come back and give it tenfold.
Yeah. You're creating an impact, and what a story. I really think we need to somehow create a segment, you know, just telling these stories, because, you know, I've got goosebumps just imagining them in my mind.
Yeah, you know what I'd love to do too. If there's some way we can create that where people can text in and tell us their stories.
I love that.
Toy Fund's impact was to your child. That would be huge for us, because I love hearing that feedback. I love seeing what a toy's done for that child and how it helped them get through their situation. So if there's some way we can hook that up, that would be a blast, because I'm hoping we get a lot of feedback from, you know, children or parents who got toys back and how it helped their child through that situation.
If there's a will, there's a way. Let's make it happen. I love it. I love it.
I was only able to push a button today to get to you. You did all this other stuff to make it happen. So I'm grateful for it. Listen, my board, myself, my staff, you don't know what you're doing for us just to get our word out there. That's the best part of our cause, is to let people know we're out there. We can do this for you if you have a kid to need. And thank you. That's the best part. We were supposed to have a 25th anniversary party, but due to COVID, we couldn't. We were going to have a big picnic set up with bounce houses, free to families to come just to say thank you. But right now we just couldn't do it this year. And I don't know if we're going to put it off to the 30th now, but we're still in conversations with that, with the board. You got to understand, I got 22 bosses, Ben. Okay. So, and they're phenomenal. They really are. They're very supportive. They've been great they helped with the toy drive. They all come out on certain days and help and be present. Rock Environmental, Kevin Perry, who owns that organization, created a mobile toy box. So we bought that from location to location. People can drop off toys. So we're going to make that bigger and better for next year. Almost like Where's Waldo? We're going to have Where's the Box? Okay. So we're going to make that even stronger for next year. But that's just it. People come out of the community. Gary Federico from Federico Wrecking has been phenomenal. You know, he's one of my best friends, but he's always there to help my cause or introduce somebody that can help the problems that I have. So God bless him too. So, but that's what makes the world go round, is good people, like you just said, surrounding yourself that believe in what you believe in. And a lot of it is respect. I think you got to have respect. If you don't respect somebody, and like you say, you might not agree with them all the time, but if you respect that person, you're going to have a final outcome, which is unsurpassed. You really will. But it's all about respect. When you don't respect, nothing gets done.
If you don't respect, nothing gets done. I like that.
That. You know, and there's been bosses I respected. I didn't like them, but I respected them. But we made stuff happen. We got jobs done. We arrested bad people. But there's ones that I dealt with that just were just on their own, out on a certain ledge, and nothing got done. So if you respect somebody, you'll get the job done.
Yeah, I'm not going to call him out. I had a boss. I didn't like him at all. Respect the hell out of him. And he helped shape who I am today. So
there you go.
They don't have to be your best friend, you know?
No, they don't. You don't have to share a garbage plate with them. But yeah, they taught you a certain thing. You know what it does? It also teaches you not to be that way. You know, so you got certain bosses that come out a certain way and say, I'm never going to be that way. I don't want to be that way. So that helps, like you just say, form you to who you are today.
I love it. Hey, let's keep it lighthearted and fun at the end here. I like to do a rapid fire round. Simple, you know, fill in the blank, either or questions where let's get to know you a little bit better and wrap up on a high note here.
Not a problem.
Are you a coffee or tea drinker?
Both.
Both. What about beer or wine?
I don't drink. I'll have a little wine once in a while if it's a very sweet wine, you know. Riesling, I love a Riesling, but I'm not into it as much.
Hey, listen, I support that. I used to be quite the drinker. I've reduced it. I haven't drank in almost 3 months. I haven't drank in almost 3 months, and I feel like $1 million. I took 2 years off my life. So, social media platform. Is there any social medias that Pirate Toy Fund is most active? You're most active. If I want to go follow something, well, where would I go?
I'm just now getting on Facebook. I was in law enforcement. You never put any of your family or business out there. So I was never on any social medias. So I'm just now learning the Facebook and trying to get on that. But Pirate Toy Fund's on Facebook. We're on Twitter. We're on all those things. You can contact us that way. But I'm hopefully I'm going to learn this and be able to communicate a little bit better in my new role here.
Hey, we'll put the links in the show notes. So go to the notes, the description of this video or the podcast. You'll see it there. Lastly, when you were a child, did you have a favorite toy? Did you have a favorite hobby? What comes to mind?
I loved Slinkies and Matchbox cars. The only thing is my Slinky, I loved it. I broke it within 3 minutes because it got twisted or and then I fell down the steps a few times trying to chase it. But the Matchbox cars I used to play with all the time when I was little.
I love it. I love it. Hey, Otto, I love what you do. Ultimately, the Pirate Toy Fund, you're bringing joy to children. You're help creating community. You're building those bonds, even in times of total struggle. So I appreciate the conversation. Is there anything that we didn't touch on? This is kind of just the fair game, the most open-ended question I asked. You know, anything that I would have asked you if I had known a little bit more about you or Pirate Toy Fund, anything we didn't touch on that you'd like to add today?
I think we hit on a lot, pretty much everything. The biggest thing I like to emphasize is that we're here year round. We give out to the community 12 months a year, over 34,000 toys we gave out the year before COVID to 70 plus agencies, which is huge. And it's at no cost to them. It's all done by fundraisers, all done by donations. It's all done by grants. But Ben, I got to come out again and say thank you, because what you're doing and getting the word out about Rochester and getting the word about, you know, us, the Pirate Toy Fund and other charities is huge, because everybody needs that. Everybody needs to know there's people out there caring. There's people out there doing God's work. So thank you so much for putting this out here. I really do appreciate it.
Hey, it's humbling. This is the best part of my day. And I'll be honest, I'm waiting for the COVID thing to die down so I can see you with a beard, the Santa Claus thing.
I just shaved it the other day because I get so lazy because I just go. But mine would never look as good as yours, let me tell you. But I can't wait till things calm down. We can go out and get some lunch or something. And I'd love to pick your brain about some other things and stuff and what you do and how we can get people talking about their toy experience. So.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We'll talk more soon.
Thank you so much for everything.
Thanks for listening to Rochester Business Connections. Don't forget to share this, rate, and comment on your favorite platform. You can also email me, ben@valbertmarketing.com. Let's connect soon. Until then, keep thriving, everyone.